Blackstone Audio and Skyboat Media present Untouched by Human Hands by Robert Sheckley. This book is read by Gabrielle de Cuir, Harlan Ellison, and Stefan Rudnicki. To Barbara.
The Monsters. Cordover and Hum stood on the rocky mountaintop watching the new thing happen. Both felt rather good about it. It was undoubtedly the newest thing that had happened for some time.
By the way the sunlight glints from it, Hum said, I'd say it is made of metal.
I'll accept that, Cordover said. But what holds it up in the air?
They both stared intently down to the valley where the new thing was happening. A pointed object was hovering over the ground. From one end of it poured a substance resembling fire.
It's balancing on the fire, Hum said.
That should be apparent even to your old eyes.
Cordover lifted himself higher on his thick tail to get a better look. The object settled to the ground, and the fire stopped.
Shall we go down and have a closer look?
Hum asked.
All right. I think we have time. Oh, wait. What day is this?
Hum calculated silently, then said,
The fifth day of Lugget.
Damn, Cordover said. I have to go home and kill my wife.
It's a few hours before sunset, Hum said. I think you have time to do both.
Cordover wasn't sure.
I'd hate to be late.
Well, then, you know how fast I am, Hum said. If it gets late, I'll hurry back and kill her myself. How about that?
Well, that's very decent of you.
Cordover thanked the young man, and together they slithered down the steep mountainside. In front of the metal object, both men halted and stood up on their tails.
Rather bigger than I thought,
Cordover said, measuring the metal object with his eye. He estimated that it was slightly longer than their village, and almost half as wide. They crawled a circle around it, observing that the metal was tooled, presumably by human tentacles. In the distance, the smaller sun had set.
I think we had better get back,
Cordover said, noting the cessation of light.
I still have plenty of time.
Hum flexed his muscles complacently.
Yes, but a man likes to kill his own wife.
As you wish.
They started off to the village at a brisk pace. In his house, Cordover's wife was finishing supper. She had her back to the door, as etiquette required. Cordover killed her with a single flying slash of his tail, dragged her body outside, and sat down to eat. After meal and meditation, he went to the gathering. Hum, with the impatience of youth, was already there telling of the metal object. He probably bolted his supper, Cordover thought with mild distaste. After the youngster had finished, Cordover gave his own observations. The only thing he added to Hum's account was an idea that the metal object might contain intelligent beings.
What makes you think so?
Michel, another elder, asked.
The fact that there was fire from the object as it came down, Cordover said, joined to the fact that the fire stopped after the object was on the ground. Some being, I contend, was responsible for turning it off.
Not necessarily, Michel said.
The village men talked about it late into the night. Then they broke up the meeting, buried the various murdered wives, and went to their homes. Lying in the darkness, Cordover discovered that he hadn't made up his mind yet about the new thing. Presuming it contained intelligent beings, would they be mortal? Would they have a sense of right and wrong? Cordover doubted it and went to sleep. The next morning, every male in the village went to the metal object.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.